Majel Barrett, Gene Roddenberry's wife, said that Dad was a gentleman's gentleman. And I think he was just very unusual in that, especially, you know, being an actor through the 60s and 70s and 80s when, you know, values and morals were sort of shifting. He sort of always maintained a certain level of poise. He was always, he was just very graceful and elegant and had just an incredible amount of integrity.
When he was ready to go to college, he decided that he'd go into the Foreign Service. That was his first career plan. And then later he decided he'd like to be a writer. And a friend of his was directing a play in which he wanted a writer to play the part of the writer, James Joyce. So he started vacillating between acting and writing. And finally ended up as an actor. I was in an acting class and he was in an acting class, and we did a scene together, and that's how we met. He went to audition for the Romulan commander on Star Trek about 2 months after he arrived in California, and he got the role.
He really liked the Romulan commander. Mm-hmm. He really did, because it was such a great role for him. He was a soldier, he was basically the enemy, and yet he had that warm side to him. And he really felt like he could really act.
Centurion, I find myself wishing for destruction before we can return. Were I not, like you, I am too well trained in my duty to permit it. Continue evasive maneuvers. Now, back to the first course.
What do you remember about the Romulan commander?
I think he really got into that role and enjoyed it enormously, and had a very big part. And just philosophically, I think it was nice, because even though he and Kirk were enemies, part of the script was that he would say in the end, you know, at another time, if this was another time in history, maybe, you know, I could call you friend.
What purpose will it serve to die?
We are creatures of duty, Captain. I have lived my life by it. Just one more duty to perform.
I think it was nice for him to be involved in a show that was progressive in that way, that dealt with the future, because he was such an optimist and he believed that humankind was improving and evolving. People have come up to him and written letters to him and emails to him about how Star Trek sort of saved their lives, you know, that they were into drugs or going down the wrong path and sort of got involved, if you will, with Star Trek, and it sort of kind of set them on a different path.
I was going to say, too, is that a lot of fans really appreciated him when he went to the conventions, because they said that he was really kind of a father figure, that they adopted that good aspect of the part that was the good father they could identify with. And so in a sense, he sort of became what they termed the world's father. And that was also the ambassador part of the character. So he was sort of the ambassador to the nations and sort of the father to all, which is kind of, you know, I sort of felt honored as his daughter that people would see him in that light.
And actually, he originally wanted to be an ambassador.
Genesis,
you know, he studied for the Foreign Service and had thought he would be an ambassador, so it was sort of nice that he actually, you know, became an ambassador and to much greater proportions than he could have imagined.
Father, I will be returning to Vulcan within the hour. I would like to take my leave of you.
It was most kind of you to make this effort.
It is no effort. You are my son. Besides, I'm most impressed with your performance in this crisis.
Star Trek became so much a part of his life because not only did he do the original series and The Next Generation and one of the animated shows and the movies, but he had these ongoing conventions that were going on all over the world. And they also had Star Trek cruises. So we got to take the whole family to the Bahamas and Jamaica and the Cayman Islands and have a Star Trek convention at sea. So it was sort of just this ongoing source of connectedness to the whole Star Trek world. He frequently would tell the story about the first time he ever went to a Star Trek convention. He had no idea what to expect. and didn't really know that some of the questions were going to be very intelligent. He just didn't know what was going on. So he was just up there, and people were doing the question and answer. And somebody raised their hand and said, can you please tell me when logic first came to Vulcan? So he had to really think about it because he had no idea. He didn't write the scripts, and he just had played the character once of Sarek at that point. And so he thought about it for a while, and then he just looked up at the person and said, about the same time it left the planet Earth.
We have several sets of Star Trek ears, you know, Sarek ears, which is fun.
Because they put a new set on every time.
Yeah.
They have to remove the little piece of foam, sort of like a prosthetic that goes over the top part of the ear. Mm-hmm. So we have bunches of those. He was playing Spock's father, Sarek, for the first time with Jane Wyatt. And Captain he King. Had to arrive at the set, you know, 4 a.m. or whatever it was to do the 3 hours of makeup. And he had the eyebrows done and the ears done and all the heavy makeup. And his hair was dyed as well so that he would look like Leonard Nimoy's father because they were about the same age. So Jane Wyatt came onto the set and they did their part together. And then he got all cleaned up and was going out to the parking lot and saw Jane Wyatt across the way and waved and said hi. And she looked up like, you know, who's that? And he yelled over, I'm your husband.
Dad actually said that he really enjoyed playing the role as Sarek on The Next Generation because it was a multi-dimensional role where he was playing alongside Patrick Stewart.
Am I to be blamed for the judgment of a child? Sagath is young and inexperienced. He erred in his assumption that I needed help.
But you needed his help at the concert. Or is there possibly some other logical explanation for what happened that night?
What happened?
I saw you crying.
I did not cry.
I was there. I saw the tears.
You exaggerate, Captain. I recall only one tear.
So you were emotionally affected by the music?
That is not possible!
You still haven't answered my question, Sarek. Is it logical for a Vulcan to cry?
It was late. I was fatigued. Nothing more. The Logarans trust only me. They will not meet with any other member of the Federation. I must be allowed to complete my mission. There are no other logical solutions.
He said that that reminded him of King Lear, that role. He really did that. He let the emotion just come right out, and it was really quite beautiful to watch that. Well, you know that this hand sign is not that easy to do.
Yeah, not everybody can do that.
And, like, I think I remember Dad telling a story about how he had to come down the aisle and he had to very, you know, sort of majestically do this and not do it messed up at all. And I remember he was saying that his thought process was, oh, my God, I've just got to get this right. And then he did it. He hit it, and he was really happy.
Live long and prosper, my son.
I remember when Dad was doing Star Trek IV, before he got into the filming of it, he obviously had read the script and knew what it was about. And I grew up loving dolphins and whales. And he wouldn't tell me too much about what the movie was about other than it was about whales.
I remember two things that Dad did. He sat on his bed with the script for a long time and just read it. You know, he didn't do any other special thing except one other special thing. He'd ask one of his daughters to read, or his wife, to read the lines with him. I remember he signed one of the scripts to me, said, "Dear to Kathy, thank you for your help, love Dad," and that meant a lot to me.
If I had to describe my dad, and you had never met him before, had never seen him on any part, and had no idea anything about him, it would sound like an unreal person, because he was just an exceptional human being. He was a very nurturing father. He was very present. He was private, but loving. He loved nature. He was intelligent. He loved his work. He loved acting.
I think if there's something about Mark that people haven't seen of him, that I think is interesting is his humor. I think most people didn't get a chance to see that side of him.
I think another interesting fact about Dad that most people wouldn't be privy to is his sense of adventure. You know, he would just go out there and do things, and he taught me how to body surf when we moved out to L.A. Went over one of these enormous waves and got a little skin on his nose and had to go to a Star Trek convention, I think. Leonard Nimoy went up and asked what had happened to his nose, and he said, oh, I was teaching my daughter how to body surf.
I think some of my favorite memories are as an adult, being with him when I was older. because I could appreciate him more as a person, as well as a dad. He really became a friend. And I think that my greatest memory is being in New York with him, where we developed a friendship. And we were sort of, you know, in my little mind, we were almost on equal terms because we were both adults. And we came to have this relationship and we reconciled. And that was the most meaningful thing to me.
Our dad was one of the fortunate few that never had to wait tables as someone that had a profession as an actor. Certainly everybody has some slow times, but he was able to work full time in acting for 50 years of his life. And actually the last 10 or 15 years was on a real upswing and got to really see a wide spectrum, a very broad spectrum of what it is to express yourself as an actor. So I think he felt, you know, pretty happy about that. He got to live his dream. He got to live as an actor and work as an actor and really loved the whole process.
I think that Mark will be remembered as Sarek, because that seemed to be the part that everyone kind of identified him with.
Personally, I'll remember him as being my best friend for my whole life. And a very nurturing person with the highest integrity, a wonderful role model and mentor. You know, as far as the public, I think he'll be remembered as the ambassador and the leader and the father figure from, you know, this enormously successful program that's ongoing.
Roberta and I are on the same wavelength, because I was just going to say ambassador and father for the public for sure. And for my own personal, definitely would be friend.
One year we were walking down the streets in New York and looking in the bookstore windows, and a book caught my eye that was called The Meaning of Life. And turns out Dad bought a copy for me and a copy for Kathy. And I think that what was interesting was that he was sort of open to interpreting that. He was constantly taking in information and wanting to learn. And he wrote in the book, insight, happiness, joy, and love. You know, love, Dad. And it was really sort of sums up a lot of his philosophy and his own spirituality.